That's going to be bright. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real delight to see you. We're really pleased to welcome you to this live taping of this important conversation concerning the intersection of history, the work of memory and remembrance, and the arts. This weekend, the Kansas City Heartland Men's Chorus will present its summer concert, Indivisible Songs of Resistance and Remembrance, which explores the dynamics between patriotism and protest in a democracy. And in Act One of that concert will be the world premiere of a major new choral work, We the Unknown. And this work tells the story of how the unknown soldier of World War I was chosen. And tonight we'll have a conversation about that, as well as the background of the period where it finds its roots. So I'm Matt Naylor, and I serve as the president of the and CEO at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we're really delighted to introduce our four guests tonight. Tim Kasich, who is the composer of the work, and then we have Pat Daneman and Rob Hill, who are the co-librettists. Is that the right way of say that?
Librettists.
Yeah. There you go. And then Dr. Jason Crouthamel from the Grand Valley State University, who serves as a professor of history. So welcome to all of you. We're glad to have you as our guests here at the National World War I Museum, and we're really delighted to have this live audience for this taping. Rob, I think that it was probably 4 or 5 years ago that at an event when we met, and you mentioned that the Heartland Men's Chorus was in its very early stages of developing a work with a World War I theme. And might I also comment that Rob is a volunteer here at the museum and serves, in fact, in a number of civic roles, including a long-time service with the Heartland Men's Chorus. So that particularly intrigued me about that. So you conceived of this work, We the Unknown. Tell us about that. How did you come up with that idea and the notion of this work?
About a decade ago, I was working at Wentworth Military Academy, which is east in Lexington, Missouri, and the superintendent, a retired Army two-star, it was either Memorial Day or Veterans Day, and we had an assembly for the cadets. And he read a very brief history about how the unknown soldier was selected.
Right, why don't you tell us, remind us about that early after the war, what happened and why and how that was selected?
A number of our allies, the British and the French in particular, had undertaken efforts to honor veterans of the First World War, and had, I think, Britain first, and had come up with this idea about honoring an unknown soldier. And so some individuals here in this country came to, I think, Senator Fish from New York, and lobbied him to see if we could not do something similar. So in 1921, the decision was made. The Army quartermaster forces in France were given the task, and so they went about this very elaborate process of exhuming eight bodies, four primary, four alternate, and from each of four major battlefields, and brought them to a village in France and put them all into a room. And multiple times the caskets were switched about. And then a well-decorated sergeant, Edward F. Younger, was given the task of going into the room and was given a bouquet of white roses. So he went into the room, there were these four flag-draped coffins, and he felt led to circle them three times and then felt a particular he was drawn to one in particular. And he felt like, I mightn't have known this soldier. So that's the casket on which the white roses were placed. That unknown became the unknown, America's unknown, that then came back to America and was interred at Arlington.
Yeah. When you enter the National World War I Museum and Memorial, underneath the glass bridge, going into the main galleries are 9,000 poppies, similar to the poppies that you'll see here, each representing 1,000 combatant deaths. So conservatively 9 million combatants killed. But it strikes me, Jason, you'd have a sense of this. How do you count? How would you know anyway? Because the numbers were so extreme. Consider the Battle of the Somme, the British having 20,000 casualties on day one, 1 million lost at Verdun, yeah. You know, 750,000 only 200 miles away at the Somme. The extent of the carnage was so extreme that no wonder there were so many soldiers unknown. How then do we honor those which aren't identified?
Absolutely, absolutely. It's almost impossible to grasp. My students struggle with this. You know, 20,000 British soldiers, you know, lost in the first few hours of the Battle of the Somme on July 1st, 1916. And I try to break down the numbers of people killed in the two world wars, you know, that are almost abstractions to younger people today, I think.
Yeah.
And I think there's a great technique for trying to break down just four people, four unknowns, and trying to imagine who those individuals were as people.
Yeah. And so then, Rob, you took the story and turned it into some sort of choral work. Tell us about that.
Well, almost immediately when I heard the story, I was just, a question came into my mind, and that was, well, what if this unknown, the one selected, was a young gay man? Or what if this individual was an African American who, although they fought heroically, were often given sort of the worst jobs that you could have, like in many cases, and you can correct me if you know, Jason, like they were given the task of going to basically retrieve dead bodies. So, and so that question just sort of, and then over time, I started fleshing out possibilities. If I had to put labels on the four individuals, I thought one was a bully, one was gay, one was African American, and almost from the beginning I thought the fourth one won't tell his own story, but instead his mother will tell his story. But if it's all right, we have one of our soloists from this weekend who is here this evening, and he's gonna sing the unknown number three in the work, We the Unknown, which is the young gay man telling his story. So Christopher Kurt is our soloist, and his accompanist is Lamar Sims, who is our accompanist for the Heartland Men's Chorus. So we'll take a quick little break to listen to them because they have to go to rehearsal this evening. So I will let them do their thing.
Yeah, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome then Christopher and Lamar.
Thank you. strive to separate us along the way, but failed and failed again. Now alone in an abandoned trench, we wait for tomorrow's pre-dawn fight, the one for which the captain
Wonderful. Thank you, gentlemen. So it takes a team, though, Rob, I think, to write something like this. Pat and Tim, you got involved in this. How did that happen? Mm-hmm. What were the roles that you played?
Well, somehow Rob found me, and I always say I felt very lucky that that happened, but he had conceived of this original work, the structure of it, the characters, the framework where Sergeant Younger was going to be walking around and choosing, and he wrote the stories of each of these four unknowns. And then I think what happened, I still wasn't part of it yet, is that he was working with Tim, and in kind of looking at where it was going to go next, Tim perhaps suggested that a poet get involved, I think. And so Rob found me in the wide morass of poets in Kansas City. He liked the work of mine that he was able to find, and he contacted me out of the blue and said, "Would you be interested in taking this on?" And the odd thing was that I had been in England the summer before. I had been to a little village called Mega Vizzy, I think, where they were celebrating, or I say celebrating, I shouldn't, they were commemorating the centennial of World War I there and all of the people that they had lost. And I got very involved in the stories of 13 of the lost men of Mega Vizzy, and I was trying to write a long poem about that, and having no success whatsoever. And then all of a sudden I heard from Rob, and I'm like, well, I'm perfectly happy to give this a try. It sounds like a wonderful, wonderful project.
Well, how wonderful that you'd had that experience being in those villages and towns. Mm-hmm. One of the things you would have seen is that village after village after village would have a memorial, of course, with name after name after name. young man or the older young men of the village often. The notion of pals brigades where all the cricket team or all the football team would sign up together. They had to change the way of doing that because whole villages of men would be lost.
This particular one, I think 15 men went away and 3 came back.
Yeah, devastating. Yeah. Devastating impact on places. So that gave you this sense of that, as well as no doubt immersing yourself in some of the poetry of World War I, which is extraordinarily rich.
It is, and I didn't really do that much of that. I felt a little bit of a time pressure. I spent more time researching the original story that Rob had worked on. I went back and I knew that it was a work of your imagination, but I wanted to know how much was imagination and how much of it was real, and it turned out it was all real, with Sergeant Younger and the choosing, and then that was when imagination began. And I researched the role of African Americans, and I just tried to get back to a sense of what that war was like, because I don't think I knew as much about World War I studying in college and so forth as I did about World War II, so yeah. It was an education that way.
Yeah, thank you. Tim, then your experience in doing this.
Yeah, so Dustin Cates, who is the artistic director of Heartland Men's Chorus, sent me an email years back sort of outlining the project and asking if I'd be interested in being the composer who would then set this project to music. And I had a number of questions for him about it, just for him to answer, and one of them was about the libretto, and even before I had read it or seen it, the question was, is the libretto finalized, or is there any room for a collaborative relationship between the librettist and myself as we work? As a composer who works a lot with vocal music and setting text to music, I'm really particular about the words and about the character, and so, I wanted to make sure that it didn't feel like work for hire from me, saying, well, here's what we need you to be inspired by, go. You know, so I wanted to make sure that if there were things that I thought we could change or questions that I had, that there'd be a working relationship between Rob and I. So I think that me sort of being the stone in Rob's shoe and coming back with question after question about the characters, about the libretto, about word choices, about do you mean this here, or could it also mean this? I think that may have been the catalyst for Rob and Pat to get together and work together on the libretto.
So I've heard it said that when an architect is asked to do a commission, for example, for a building design, they'll go onto the land, and if within the first little while, you know, they haven't developed their idea, then they give it to their intern to do, or you know, or they don't take the job. The idea is that you very quickly get a conceptual framework which develops from what's being offered by the client and by the land and so forth. What about your experience in reading, you know, Rob's initial work and such? How does the creative process work for you to then write the music?
Well, my instinct and my inspiration is to make something new for the world, right? I wanted to cast ideas and stories into a new light so people can actually listen and pay attention. I feel like I ask a lot of the audience in the music that I write. On paper, when it was asked of me saying, would you write a piece about World War I, about the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, I thought, that maybe, you know, that a lot of music has been written about war, a lot of music has been written about World War I. One of the reasons Dustin had asked me was because of my involvement in another project about the World War I Christmas truce. So I thought, well, I've sort of worked on that already, so maybe I wouldn't have anything new to say about that. Once I got Rob's libretto, though, and read through it, I thought, there's music here to be written. And so it was actually reading the words that made it an easy way to say yes for me.
So, you know, Jason, Rob mentioned that one of the unknowns imagined is gay in the story, which led me to think about ideas of what people thought of soldiers around that time and the notions of masculinity, about what it meant to be a man or a bloke. In your text, Masculinity, Sexuality, and German Soldiers in the First World War, you write, Men searched, often desperately, for emotional support and intimacy, which included confessions of vulnerability and hunger for nurturing compassion. Absolutely. How so? How did the German men on the front find intimacy and emotional support?
Well, that was something that was new that emerged out of the war, because when the war broke out, there was a very fixed idea about masculinity that was promoted by conservative pastors and doctors and politicians, which created an idea of men were supposed to be self-controlled, their emotions were supposed to be controlled. They're supposed to be entirely dedicated to sacrifice for their country, a very militaristic warrior image. And that image excluded homosexuals. It's an exclusively heterosexual image. In fact, showing emotions openly was considered to be a homosexual degenerate behavior, according to doctors at the time. But the reality of the war was that it broke down that image. You know, doctors had argued, politicians had claimed that the war was healthy for men. It would reinforce masculinity. There have been too many decades of peace, right? And the war would reinforce men's sense of manhood.
That we were becoming soft because weren't fighting enough.
One doctor said they're going to movies and they're cooking and they're writing poetry. It's been since 1870 there had been a good war, they said, right? But the reality, of course, of the trenches of World War I and industrialized warfare was that for many men, that image of the self-controlled, emotionally suppressed soldier, one soldier, Wilfred Owen, argued that it was inhumane. Like Owen inspired some of the libretto with his most famous poem, Dulce et Decorum Est. And the shell shock that Owen and others experienced caused many of these men to rebel against that old image. At Craig Lockhart Hospital in Scotland, Owen and Sassoon and other British soldiers, they started to argue that manhood could include expressing emotions of fear and anxiety, as well as love and compassion. They said this is actually essential to surviving war and to recovering from it. That was expressed oftentimes through, in Central Europe, it's called comradeship. Anglo-American term, band of brothers, might be familiar. The idea of a sacred bond between soldiers and war that promoted a very manly, masculine, soldierly image, but it also allowed for love and compassion to be expressed between men in close friendship. That was something that was observed by, quite famously, is actually Dr. Magnus Hirschfeld, who was the co-founder of the first gay rights organization in Berlin in 1897, interviewed thousands of gay soldiers in World War I. And he argued that gay men were perfectly suited to war, because he believed that gay men were a third sex, he called them. They're a mixture of masculine and feminine emotions, right? And so they embodied that spirit of comradeship, ancient Spartan ideal, he claimed, right? And so he made the case that through their sacrifice in war, gay men could earn the deserved respect and to tear down the laws that criminalize homosexuality. Hirschfeld argued that men who were gay were born that way, right? Lady Gaga should pay copyright fees. That was the cornerstone of his movement. It was the first gay rights movement, and it was internationally acclaimed. It had over 600,000 members throughout the world, and many of them were veterans in the war. Ironically, though, many of those veterans were actually somewhat critical of Hirschfeld's idea that it was a mixture of masculine and feminine emotions. There are many veterans who were homosexual who saw the masculine warrior ideal as something they wanted to embrace. The gay rights movement was actually quite divided in the 1920s between those who embraced a kind of a feminine image and those who embraced a kind of a masculine image. Yeah. It was unified around the idea of tearing down the laws that criminalized gay male behavior.
So there was really quite a divide that developed with the popular notion of the masculine male, what's to be expected, and then what the experience actually was in the trenches. I'm struck by some of the letters that men wrote home, sometimes to their girlfriends or their wives, where they're confessing the profound sense of loss that they're experiencing as friend after friend or colleague after colleague after colleague are killed.
Yeah.
And then the deep loneliness and no doubt fear that they're experiencing, and then yearning for some understanding on the other side, but not finding it because it's in sharp contrast to their expectation of what the masculine experience is.
Absolutely, it's a very complex phenomenon. You know, there's a huge gap widening between those at home and those at the front and their experiences. But there's also a kind of a sense of closeness. Many men at the front try to reach out to women at home. Their girlfriends, their wives, their mothers also, and to try to express what they're going through, to open up their emotions. Sometimes they'd hold it back. They would say, look, I know as a man I'm not supposed to talk about this. And I don't think I can because you'd never understand. But there are other cases of men who were trying to open up the best they could. I found a case of a German soldier writing letters home every day to his fiancée. And in some of the letters, he just wrote the word love, line after line after line, just the word love. And he said, you know, I feel so close to you, right, that we're going through a trauma, you on the home front, starvation and stress, worrying about me here, you know, we're bonded by this. And in many of these cases, these men were able to, and women at home also, to open up with each other to some degree.
Mm. Yeah, a radical redefinition of masculinity.
This is why I characterize it as we see during the war an explosion of what I call a spectrum of masculinities, plural.
Right.
Because if there's a kind of a fixed image in the media that's, one could say, was already contested even before the war, but those who started to contest that image became more the mainstream during and after the war. It'd be harder to claim after the war there's a fixed image that those who had not experienced combat could claim what masculinity really is. And many men in the front who experienced shell shock, the trauma of loss, loved ones, the stress and anxiety of facing violence every day, they started to assert that they were the authentic caretakers of what masculinity really was. Mm. And it's very complex.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Tim, let's talk about the structure of the work for a little. It's got 12 movements to it. Talk about the composition process. How did it start? How did it come together? How do you differentiate? Talk to us about the structure of writing that sort of work.
Sure. Well, it's funny you mentioned architecture before, because I liken my process to that of an architect a lot, in that I have to sort of create a plan for the work I'm about to do and almost design a blueprint for the piece first before any notes are written, so that when I sit down to the piano, I'm able to have some sort of goal ahead of me rather than just, you know, some empty land and a pile of wood and then just starting from there. So I used Rob's libretto as the basis, even before Pat got involved, just as far as who are these characters, what is their language, what are their themes, how is this work divided. The libretto that I got from Rob was basically one long text document, and I knew that in my work I didn't necessarily want to write one long non-stop work. I want it to be in sections. One of the things that I think about a lot in my work as a composer is the balance between pushing an audience's ear and giving them something new to listen to and sort of asking them to pay attention. And also the flip side of that is this element of familiarity, so that around every corner is not something new, because I think that can get very exhausting as a listener when you're so lost, you're not quite sure what to expect, and you're reaching for something to hold on to, and the next thing you hear is something brand new again or different. So in my work, I'm always trying to balance those things out.
So like there's, you have some common themes that emerge now and again.
Yeah.
In the word. So would you classify the movements as chapters or paragraphs?
Maybe both.
Uh-huh.
I think, to me, the cornerstones of the work are the four unknown soldiers, including the mother's telling of her son's story, and then that fifth one being Sergeant Younger's experience as he's circling these caskets trying to choose. In some ways, his story becomes the glue that holds these four together. He's almost like the narrator. And then the four soldiers' stories are the cornerstone. So that sort of emerged to me very quickly as a visual structure of how this thing could be laid out.
So as when we anticipate hearing this, is there a re-emerging lilt or theme that we can look forward to?
Yeah, and so one of the things that I'll do after I've sort of gone through the libretto and made larger breaks in between the themes and sections is I'll think, okay, well, what is this section about? Is there a musical gesture or sound, or since we've got a chamber orchestra, is there a selection of instruments that can characterize Sergeant Younger or Unknown Soldier number 2 or 3 or this World War I poem in Flanders Fields? How will that sound different or similar to what came before it versus what came after it? And again, trying to balance out the contrast of hearing something new versus the familiarity of, oh, here comes Sergeant Younger, I know what he sounds like, and then he delivers something and you think, yes, that's what I expected from him. So there are not only musical motives that you'll hear that tie it all together, but there are also instrument choices and harmonic choices that will be reoccurring themes throughout.
Yeah, great. Sometimes there are people put surprises in musical compositions or in movies or, mm-hmm. or whatever, Easter eggs sometimes or hidden gems. Have you hidden in the in their surprises for us?
Yeah, there are things, and I don't know that I would call them surprises or Easter eggs, because sometimes I feel like that's kind of tongue-in-cheek, and the creator is sort of winking at the audience saying, did you find this? For me, it's a method by which I can keep myself sane and keep coming back to the same thing. So there is a specific theme that you'll hear underneath Sergeant Younger's voice from the string quartet, and it's sort of this chromatic wandering motive that to me exemplifies his circling around these caskets as he's trying to choose, and he's trying to figure out where he is and which one he's going to choose. That appears throughout the piece as he comes back, so sometimes it takes longer to get through and it's in a different key, but that's always there. And there are a couple other motives that I'll use here and maybe bury it in the score later on, just so that I'm using the same idea but in a different way, so that it's not yet one more idea, but it's making the piece a little bit more economical musically.
So Pat then, and Rob, did you then work with that as the music developed? Are you musical? Do you listen to it and say, now we need to do work poetically in these areas?
That is not how I did it. I tried to bring the music of language into the work that Rob had done, and in order to pass that off to Tim. Mm-hmm. So I was going for more of a with my poet's ear, kind of how it sounded. I tried to work some rhyme in, internal rhyme and assonance, and just kind of use all of those little tools to make it pleasing to hear. But I still have not heard it. So,
Well, it's going to be a surprise for you. Now, you included Seeger's poem, I Have a Rendezvous with Death. Was that, Rob, was that your... So why'd you include that? I'm looking at it here. You've got notes there, I see too, Tim. So why'd you include, that's a pretty powerful piece, which incidentally we had at, those of you who are at the Memorial Day ceremony on Monday, John Brancy sang to a new musical setting.
Yeah, I had not known that they had also set it to music.
Yeah.
And I picked it because it's long been one of my favorite poems of war. I got a master's degree in English and wrote a paper about Seeger's poetry.
Fabulous.
That's how kind of inspired I was, but it always went back to that that poem in particular. And he was an interesting young man who was sort of out anachronistic. He was a contemporary of, my brain's not going to work right now, T.S. Eliot, who was sort of forward-looking in terms of modernist poetry, but Seeger was very much a backward-looking poet, and wrote sort of romantic poetry in the sonnet form and other highly structured poetry. But that one just always appealed to me, and I just knew I had to integrate that into the piece.
And then you've also used Catherine Tynan joining the colors in a couple of places.
I picked that one for an interesting reason. She goes, are the young soldiers marching off to war so gay? Of course, that's the sort of antiquated meaning of the term. But it seemed appropriate because, as with others of the period, there was both that sort of patriotic, and this fits in with the larger theme of our concert, there was that balance of the patriotism, there they go, with smooth-cheeked and golden food for shells and guns. So it was that dynamic between the patriotism and the grim horror of war, and Tim just integrated that in amazingly well with the mother, the Gold Star Mother solo. It just was, and we didn't use the entire poem, we just used some snippets, but just enough that it counterbalances the mother's story very well.
Rob, not everybody may be familiar, everybody may, but they may not be familiar with Gold Star, the Gold Star family's Gold Star mothers.
I'm not an expert, except that it was during World War I that I think Congress authorized families to be able to hang a flag, what's called a service flag, in their window. It's red bordered and white field, and for every son at that particular time, it now applies to women as well. You have a blue star if your son or daughter is off at war, in conflict, and should one of them perish, then the blue star turns gold. So that's, and there's an organization that continues to exist today, Gold Star Mothers of America, and it just seemed that this would fit very nicely to be able to tell an unknown from the mother's perspective, but also honor that aspect of the period.
Because this unknown soldier has arguably millions of families who are Gold Star families, Gold Star mothers and fathers. At our Memorial Day ceremonies, we often recognize, we always recognize Gold Star families, and sometimes there are Gold Star families at the ceremony, and we present them with a flag. And it, for me, is absolutely the most emotional moment to have a family there whose son or daughter has recently been lost, and they're being honored with the presentation of flag. It's deeply moving. So the Tomb of the Unknown also is their story as well.
Yes.
Yeah. Jason, let's talk a little more about the relationship between men and women and its impact in war. Tell us about that.
I want to build on this topic of mothers, because I saw the rehearsal last night, and I think it's the most moving voices, and it is the mother's voice. And we have a lot of case studies through letters written between men and women on the home fronts and the combat fronts that give us a glimpse on how they perceived each other. And there's a great example. There's a family in Hamburg, Germany, where by 1915, 1916, the son started to write home saying, you know, Mom, I can't put up with this anymore. I'm going to break down. Mm-hmm. This war is horrifying. It's not the great adventure that everybody claimed. And the mother at home is saying, you know, buckle up, right? You've got to preserve your macho image. No one's going to let down the family name hearing that you're a coward, right? So sometimes it's civilians at home who were preserving that image. Some resentment started to build between men at war who felt that people at home didn't understand. In London, young women carried white feathers, symbols of cowardice. Right. On the streets of London, when they saw young men who weren't in uniform, they'd give them the symbol of cowardice to shame them on the streets. There were men who'd come home from seeing their friends get killed, who would take off their uniform for a day to go walk the streets and try to forget the war, and have someone give this to them. It created a huge friction between men and women. In all the different countries at war, morality organizations emerged that claimed that men were not focusing enough on fighting. They're spending too much time drinking, going to brothels. There are accusations from the Catholic League in Germany claiming that men weren't fighting hard enough. One pastor advocated that instead of brothels and beer, there should be prayer groups and lemonade. Right? And the resentment between the two sides here during the war, especially as the war drew out, people blaming each other for fears of defeat, this started to lead to a huge gulf between the two. But it's not an entire story. There's also, in many ways, close bonding between both sides, too. There's an historian whose work I very much admire. He's actually a sociologist named Mike Roper, wrote a book called The Secret Battle about the emotional lives of British soldiers in war. And he finds that in a lot of their letters writing home, they relied on their mothers. They wrote to their mothers and shared with them. Sometimes they say to their mothers, I'm going to tell you things that I can't even tell my friends about how horrifying this war is. And he finds the really close relationships between mothers and their sons at the front. It made me think about this with the libretto that you wrote, where in many cases mothers became a kind of a backbone, a cornerstone for these young men, trying to survive emotionally.
Yeah. I wonder if any of the three of you would be willing to talk about, is there any part of the libretto that stands out for you, that really, really grabs you?
There's a moment that I'm excited to hear as it comes together. It's towards the end of the piece, and it's when Sergeant Younger is about to choose which casket it is. And we talked about this as far as what this was going to look like on stage, and decided fairly early on that we didn't need to answer that question. You as the audience don't need to know which unknown soldier was the one that he picked, or how would we decide whether it's the one that Rob thinks it should be, or me, now that we've identified these people, now that they actually exist as characters. In the libretto it says, basically, I've made my choice and I choose ... and then there's nothing. And so we're not answering that question, but at that moment, he places the roses, and then the chorus goes on to sing, and that casket and that body ceases to become a specific person, and instead is transformed into a symbol. And this symbol now represents all that were lost and all that are unknown. And that, to me, that's the heart of the piece, is that this specific body and this specific person, whoever they were, no longer matters because they've become something larger and they become something more important. So that's, to me, that's one of my favorite moments of your work.
Yeah, I think for me, there is something in each one of the four segments where I was trying to get as realistic about war as I possibly could, having never been to war. And with the first soldier, I tried to equate fear and cowardice with love and caring, and kind of meld those two together as a way of salvation for this person. With the Gold Star mother, and I do frame it as letters home from her son. As she receives the letters from her son, it's like even though he's not there, she's watching him grow up, which is, to me, is kind of heartbreaking to realize that that's happening to your son who is in peril. And as she sees this happen with him, at the same time, he's starting to understand what he's really gotten himself into. And they're both together, even though they're apart, questioning why do we need to do this? So I was able to work in a few little things like that I felt good about.
Yeah. So. Well, we're looking forward to that. Rob, what grabs you?
Well, I love it all. So, but I'll speak to the one we've not spent a lot of time on, and that's the Black Soldier. It's a very powerful number. Tim's given it, how would I best describe it? It's just full of power. Perhaps of all the characters, the one who we might, at the time, I think, might have been considered by the general public not to be worthy, not to be equal even as a soldier, not capable of fighting with the same courage that maybe a white soldier could. This character speaks with that confidence and that certitude and says, I'm a damn good soldier. And it is inspiring to the point where at the end of the piece, he says, we're gonna fight and rise as one. And then another Latin phrase, e pluribus unum, takes over, and the entire chorus is singing. So that indeed, as a chorus, sort of by its nature, should be, we become one.
Yeah. Well, another thing to look forward to.
Yes.
We have an opportunity for some questions. We're not promising answers, but Camille has a microphone. We're going to grab this one here, and Camille will set it up, and you can move to the microphone, or if you'd rather stay where you are, in fact, you'll take it to those.
Alrighty,
yeah. Wonderful. So are there any questions?
Or as we say in the military, who has the first question?
The bravest soul.
So this is all about events 100 years ago. What does it mean today?
I'm sorry, I didn't...
This is about events 100 years ago. What does it mean today?
Well, that's the powerful thing about having this museum in our city is that, and Matt and Jason can attest to this much better than I can, but I think we see definite echoes of that era today with heightened nationalism, et cetera, tribalism. But I want to put that aside, and I think what really the key message is that those who serve, we don't always know the motive for why they served. In First World War, I think they were drafted. In other wars, they've been drafted. More recently, they volunteered. Whatever the motive, everyone is deserving of honor. So the powerful thing about the image of the unknown is that, to Tim's point, at that one moment, the unknown ceased to become a particular individual and became a universal symbol that for this nation and for other nations, about someone who gave their all, and that giving of one's all deserves our honor. And then sort of secondarily, I think it can resonate in other ways in the fact that there are those like African Americans in our history, gays in our history, who have been unknown. We may have known their names, but they've been unknown because they haven't been allowed to be their fullest or their most authentic selves. And they too need to be honored. More importantly, because we can, they need to be named and recognized. So that those are some of the things that I think make this story, a 100-year-old story, still powerful today.
What would you add? Jason, what does this matter for us today?
The war gave an image of masculinity, of committing to one's nation, of sacrificing oneself, an image that for a lot of people who before the war had been treated as outsiders, men who are African American, men who are gay. I do work on German Jewish soldiers in Germany who fought in World War I to prove that they were not outsiders of the nation in a society that treated them as outsiders. And that image, right, caused a lot of them to feel that they could earn respect and earn a sense of dignity. And that's something we still see today, 100 years later. And a few years ago, a gay soldier at a political convention was booed by people who, you know, despite his sacrifice for his country, right, despite his dedication to his nation, was still treated as an outsider. But he still saw it as an opportunity to prove that he wasn't an outsider at all. I think that pattern really began in this crucible of the modern world, the experience of the First World War, right, which gave a lot of groups who had been treated as marginalized an opportunity to prove, right, their desire to be part of the mainstream or to deserve respect from it.
Mm. Other questions? I see down the front.
I have a very good friend, a woman, who was a nurse in the Vietnam War, and she was before Congress testifying that the women who were actually serving in Vietnam, whether it be as nurses or in other capacities, were deserving of the same benefits of the male soldiers who were benefiting from a wide array of resources and help from the government at the time. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, in the division of the four people you have up here, if any thought was given maybe to representing women's roles mm-hmm. in World War I.
Can I tackle that
one? Yes, please.
Yeah, in the First World War, in total war, right, where combat fronts and home fronts start to merge, both groups see themselves as traumatized by a kind of a singular event. I've seen letters by women, for example, who worked in munitions factories in Berlin, who said, I was wounded, right? An explosion in the factory. Or British women wrote about the poisons from the munition shells, right, that caused damage to their bodies. And I saw one woman wrote, she signed off her letter saying, I'm a front soldier too. I'm fighting on the front lines of this war. But after the war, in many ways, women's sacrifices were not remembered in the same way that men's were. This can be seen in memorials where men's losses were held as a primary, right, the primary sacrifice. Women's losses, their mourning, their sacrifice, their physical and psychological wounds, the disease of the epidemic of the flu, starvation. This was all seen as a kind of a secondary form of trauma. I think this can be seen still, I mean, link back to the first question, you know, at the Vietnam Memorial, has anyone been to it? There's a statue of a nurse about 30 or 40 yards away, kind of hard to find in the forest there, right? And some people have noted that this kind of marginalizes the experiences of women who in Vietnam were in the front lines of combat, many of them wounded and killed, right, fighting in the same ways that men were. And that still, I think, resonates for a lot of people in terms of gender, right? Whose sacrifices do we remember, right? And do we remember them equally?
And it's worth mentioning that the Hello Girls, those women who served as telephone operators, translators really, between the French front lines and the American commanders, weren't recognized by Congress as having served until the 1970s.
Not as authentic fighters.
I was going to say that this is premised on that there are four unknown soldiers in the coffins, and so we knew that they were all men. And I think that our homage to the home front and to women came in the person of the Gold Star Mother.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Good. One last question.
This is probably primarily for Jason. I'm really intrigued with the thinking about constructions of masculinity. And one of the things I know about at least the British Army, and I'm not sure if this is true in the US or in Germany, is that whereas we tend to think of wars being fought by working class people, mm-hmm. in the British Army, the nobility was there in spades, yeah. right? And especially
in the middle class too,
in
yeah.
the cavalry, right? Yeah, yeah. How does that, is that a factor in the construction of masculinity?
Oh, absolutely.
How does
absolutely.
That play out?
Yeah, that's a great question. There's different layers to this. You know, in pre-war constructions of masculinity that I mentioned, you know, the doctors and the politicians and the pastors and military leaders, so mainly middle and upper class, you know, people who wield the power to disseminate knowledge in publications and in media. Whereas working class people's voices are much more difficult to reconstruct. So in my work, I try to highlight, you know, what I argue, and Matt mentioned this, you know, ordinary men's views of masculinity, where they contest these dominant images given by people who may not have experienced war directly. But that gets complicated very much so by the British case you mentioned especially. We mentioned Sigrid Sassoon and Wilfred Owen, right, who suffered shell shock. These were upper middle class young men, right, very educated, right, who had in the beginning of the war bought into many of those old images of the adventurous masculine heroes, self-sacrifice, repress your emotions, and who by 1916, after the Battle of the Somme and after seeing friends getting killed and experiencing shell shock, started to become the most harsh critics of it. I mean, their war poetry is some of the most devastating anti-war literature that criticizes that image of, you know, that men become real men in war. They completely break that down. And those are middle class and upper class young men doing that. So in some ways, I don't want to set up too much of a dichotomy between working class men versus upper class men, because it blends, it blurs a little bit. But during the war, men who were from poorer backgrounds certainly did resent being told, right, this is how you're supposed to feel and how you're supposed to think, and you're supposed to adhere to this masculine image, and if you don't, then you're not a real man. Men who suffer from shell shock, you know, when they're told by doctors that they were cowards and weaklings, they beat up those doctors. I mean, it was by 1918, there were riots in hospitals, and men said, look, we fought in the war, we know what we're all, they said, you guys are the psychotics, you started this war, right? We're the real men who are gonna fight to end war. And peace is a masculine thing now, some said.
Rob, we've got performances coming up. Tell us about how we can get tickets.
Yes, we do. We have a number of members of the chorus and patrons in the audience tonight. But for those who've not been to our concerts before or are interested in this concert, there's some literature as you exit out. We perform at the Folly Theater downtown. The first performance is Saturday evening at 8 p.m. and there will be another performance Sunday at 4 p.m. And we're very proud and pleased that we will be joined by the men's ensemble of the U.S. Army Soldiers Chorus for these concerts. If you haven't bought tickets, the website address to do that and or the phone number to call are on the business cards or the little placards that are up on the table as you leave. And we would dearly love to have you come and see us.
Yeah, well, I certainly would want to add to that and encourage folks to take that. I'm certainly going to be there. At the National World War I Museum and Memorial, we explore many themes, and there's a lot of educational content, lectures and so forth found on our YouTube channel. If you go to theworldwar.org, you can find a link then to our YouTube channel where we have more than 250 lectures and educational offerings, and remarkably, more than 500,000 minutes a month are watched from that channel where this conversation will be hosted very shortly. So we're delighted this evening to have partnered with our guests. Please join with me in thanking Tim Takach, Pat Daneman, Rob Hill, and Jason Crouthamel. And for those of you who are in the area, and for those of you watching, we'd certainly invite you to come and visit the nation's World War I Museum and Memorial and take in, I think, what is a remarkable story to be told, which has deep resonance to our contemporary experience. Thank you and good night.
I go to my academic colleagues and I say, you know, get rid of the papers, stop reading up.